Have you wondered what would happen if I submitted my dog's saliva to a DNA testing company? Well, today I'm going to answer and go over the process of how that DNA is analyzed. Howdy, and welcome to Family History Fanatics, where we love helping you climb your family tree and have fun along the way. If you've watched any of our other videos, you've seen how I can submit a sample to the same company two completely different times, and they come up with the same information. What you may be wondering is, what about if I sent someone else's DNA or some other creature's DNA in instead of my own sample? What would the result be? Dogs are man's best friend, and so it seems likely that somebody would have sent in their dog's saliva in order to see what these DNA testing companies will do. I don't have a dog, and I have not sent in any dog's saliva, but because of the process, I understand what the potential might be. So let's go over a little bit about dog DNA as opposed to human DNA, how they're similar and how they're different, and how testing companies might look at that. To begin with, dogs are mammals, just like we are, and so we actually share a significant amount of DNA. In fact, we share about 85% of our DNA is the same with any dog. On the other hand, how that DNA is organized is a little bit different. Now, both dogs and humans have somewhere between 20,000 and 25,000 genes, but these are divided up into chromosomes in a different way. In humans, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. In dogs, they have 39 pairs of chromosomes. Now, you may be thinking, well, does it matter that they have 39 versus 23? And really, no, the number of pairs of chromosomes, for the most part, doesn't affect anything. What really matters is the actual DNA, the genes that are on those chromosomes. And so a lot of those genes between dogs and humans are the same because we have a lot of the exact same processes for life. For instance, breathing, for organ development, for the fact that we have four limbs, our bone structure, there's various similarities between all that, and that is all back related to the genes that we share in common. So knowing this, that we share about 85% of our DNA in common, would a testing company be able to give us results for our dog? Let's go over the whiteboard and show you what is happening after you submit your DNA sample. So the first thing I said is that we have 23 pairs of chromosomes as humans, and dogs have 39 pairs of chromosomes. Really, all that means is we have these sticks, and actually pairs of sticks. There's one, there's two, there's three, and on down. And that represents our DNA. And it just so happens that dogs have more of those chromosomes, but in the total length, they actually have about 20% less DNA than humans do. So the first thing that happens when we send our DNA sample off to a testing company is they take that DNA, they separate out the DNA from everything else that's there, and they amplify the DNA. What I mean by that is they make basically duplicate copies of all this DNA. And so we now have more copies and more copies and more copies, because what we need is we need to have a lot of instances to be able to recognize certain patterns along this. And so that is going to be the same whether it is for human DNA or dog DNA. They're going to take that DNA and they're going to amplify it, let's just say 1,000 times. So instead of 46 chromosomes, now we have 46,000 chromosomes. Same DNA times 1,000. So that's the first step, is amplifying that DNA, which basically just means duplicating it, making lots and lots of copies of it. The next thing is we're going to chop up that DNA. Now, like I said before, dogs and humans have different numbers of chromosomes, but that's not what really matters. What matters is the little parts within those chromosomes that define how your hair is going to look, how your bone structure is developed, and all those little things. So this next part of this process is we're going to chop up this DNA here into multiple little segments. And we're going to chop this other one here into some other segments. And likewise, this here, all throughout it. Now you may be asking, is this just randomly done? Are they just randomly, you know, chopping this up with little biological knives? And the answer is no, because there is a goal with each of these little sections that we want to do. We have two goals, so one and two. Now the first goal is we want to have a SNP. In other words, we've identified where certain places that DNA might be different are in a single letter. And so each one of those segments should have a SNP in it. So when you think about, they're testing 500,000 SNPs on our chip. Basically what that's saying is they've taken your DNA and they've chopped it up into 500,000 little segments, or at least they have 500,000 of those segments that they're looking at. The second goal then is, besides having a SNP, remember that's just a single letter, and DNA is only made up of four letters, so just knowing one letter is not going to help us identify anything, because that one letter happens millions of times, if not a billion times, all throughout your DNA. So the second goal then is that we want to have a unique sequence. Let's see if I can spell unique right. A unique sequence. Now that unique sequence is going to be something happening before, after, or before and after this SNP that is enough letters long that it's not going to appear anywhere else in your DNA. And I'm not sure the exact numbers, but let's just say that it takes 100 letters in order to find a unique sequence. So they're chopping up into 100 letter segments that have a SNP either at the beginning, at the end, or somewhere in the middle, but they know what all those other letters are because all those other letters are the same for everybody. Now, when I'm talking everybody, I'm talking humans, because this is only looking at the human sequence. So we have the chopped up DNA that's already been amplified. So we have, you know, 1,000 little tiny segments that are all the same 500,000 times. And then they're going to analyze each one of those groups of 1,000. And they do this through different chemical means where we're matching up what this sequence looks like, remember, with this one SNP difference, to our other reference population of DNA. That is, if it is an A, then it's going to be have a little marker like this attached to it. And so that DNA will attach to this and we know, hey, that's an A. Whereas if it's a C, then it's going to attach to this other one over here. And that's how they find out whether you're an A, C, T, or G all throughout this. So let's throw in, knowing that, dog DNA or parakeet DNA or any other DNA for that matter. Remember, there's a lot of DNA that is going to be the same. However, there's going to be a lot of differences. And depending on the organism type, you may have vastly different. So for instance, plants and animals separated out long ago, and so they are very different. So you're not going to have very many of these sequences that are really going to match with a plant and a human. However, with a dog and a human, or if you get closer like a chimpanzee and a human, there's still going to be a lot of these areas that match simply because we share so much DNA in common. Now, what that would do is that would then give you some results. So for instance, out of 500,000, if we're just assuming 85% of them, you know, fall within this area that they would actually be able to do this analysis, because 85% of our DNA in dogs is the same, then theoretically what you would get is you would get, you know, 400,000 out of those 500,000 SNPs back. So you'd still get a DNA file that is still pretty large. But then we come into the next thing, and that is really the quality control. So companies are going to be taking a look at this DNA. And let's say that on our dog DNA, hey, this one matched up, and this one matched up, and this one matched up. And we have lots of these that match up, but there's a few that don't match up. And so because there's a few that don't match up, in the quality control, companies already statistically know certain things. And I showed you on another video how no calls are about 0.5% or wrong calls are about 0.5%. So really you're looking at about 1% that a company is going to know is the possibility of major errors. And so what happens is as we're looking at this, we can see that, hey, just from this little sample right here, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 errors, and I've got, looks like 10 to 12, you know, actual things. Well, that's much beyond that 1% threshold. And so a company is probably going to flag this sample and say, you know what, there's something wrong with this sample. And they're going to send you an email and say, hey, there was something wrong with the sample. Do you mind giving us another sample again? In which case, they'll send you another kit. You can, you know, spit again. And if it's a human spit, then it's going to come back and it's going to be good. But if you send a dog in, it's probably going to go through the same process. And eventually they're going to say, hey, we just can't analyze this sample. What you may be wondering then is, well, why don't they tell you that, hey, this is dog DNA? That's good. Good question. And here is the answer to that. DNA has to be compared to something. In other words, until we had cracked the human genome and basically knew what the sequence of DNA for our reference human was, we didn't have a way of identifying that human DNA compared to some other DNA. So in this case, if we have unknown DNA, we're comparing that unknown DNA to human DNA at the lab. And if that unknown DNA matches, you know, 99%, 99.9% to what our human DNA is, then we say it is human DNA. On the other hand, if that unknown DNA is not human DNA, it's not going to match that high. And Even a chimpanzee or a gorilla that is very closely related to humans, if you're just comparing it to a human, there's enough difference that you're going to be able to say, this is not human. Now, what you don't know is you don't know what animal or plant or organism that DNA is yet, because you would have to compare it to a reference population. So for instance, you'd have to compare that unknown DNA to dog DNA to be able to say, oh, this is dog DNA. Or you'd have to be able to compare it to you know, some other animal's DNA in order to say, yes, this is bear DNA or elephant DNA or whatever other kind of DNA. You have to be able to compare it to that. Now you could go back and you could just look at the number of chromosomes and identify that, hey, in this cell, there's actually 39 pairs of chromosomes, there's not 23 pairs of chromosomes, but that still wouldn't tell you that it's dog DNA. What it would tell you is it's not human DNA, and it belongs to some organism that has 39 pairs of chromosomes. And you might say, well, is there only, you know, one that has 39 pairs? No, there's lots of animals that have 39 pairs of chromosomes, some of them not anywhere closely related. For instance, if we just take humans, we have 46 chromosomes, 23 pairs of chromosomes. There are, I think it's called a sable or something like that. It's like a deer-like creature. They also have 46 pairs of chromosomes, or 23 pairs of chromosomes. There's another half a dozen animals or organisms that have 23 pairs of chromosomes. The number of chromosomes doesn't determine what kind of organism you are. It is the genes within the chromosomes. And so all that counting the chromosomes would do is tell you, hey, it's not human because humans have 23 pairs of chromosomes and this DNA has 39 pairs of chromosomes. What it would give you is it would give you a pool of potential animals, which include dogs, that have 39 pairs of chromosomes. If you still have questions about DNA, then join us in our DNA live streams where we answer your questions. And consider joining FHF Extra, where we have even more DNA Q&A sessions, as well as webinars. So the answer is, if you sent your DNA into a testing company and their quality control was all up to snuff, what it would do is it would flag it and say, hey, there's something wrong with this sample. Try to get another sample. If maybe their quality control is not up to snuff, then they're going to process it anyway. And what you'll get back is you'll get back a DNA file that has a much higher amount of no calls or false calls. And when I'm talking about a much higher amount, I'm saying instead of 0.5%, we're talking 10 or 20 or 30%. Now, what this means for the rest of the DNA is it's going to match. And it's you're going to be able to find matches from it. You're going to be able to see, although because of the fact that it's from a dog as opposed to a human, you're probably not going to have any significant matches to other people just because that DNA is jumbled in different ways around. And so it's not going to be the same. Now, if you'd like to learn more about DNA, why don't you check out this video up above? And let's say that you don't want to learn any more about DNA, but you want to learn about just something else from our channel, then check out this list right here. So much information about me without a mistake. No, that's a bad one.